In 2020, President Trump, he proposed cuts to Medicaid, Medicare, Social Security even. It was largely a 180 from some of the things that he talked about in 2016. And that approach to social programs was a large deviation from what happened previously. So writer, assistant editor of The American Greatness, Pedro Gonzalez, he joins me now to discuss how the abandonment of Trump's 2016, at least economic populism, may have contributed to his defeat, or maybe it didn't. It's a big debate that's raging. Pedro, thank you for joining me, man. We really appreciate it.
Good to be here.
Absolutely. So give me this take, Pedro. There's been a lot of discussion online about how much of Trumpism itself is a cultural appeal. And I think that's undoubted at this point, given how well he did in the 2020 presidential election. However, how much do you think the economics was a key part of it?
I think it was a huge part of it. I think it was part of his appeal that he came to us as a moderate. He was the first moderate Republican, the first populist to run in a lifetime. And I think that the benefit of this was being divorced from the establishment orthodoxy, right? The Paul Ryanism, this kind of ideological affinity for free trade and tax cuts and things like that, things that are really kind of falling out of style with most Americans who no longer see these things as in their interest. So I think that the economic aspect of it was huge. And like you said, we're still trying to figure out what exactly happened in the 2020 election. And one of the most peculiar things I've seen is what you just pointed out, that now we're trying to kind of separate populism from what Trump initially ran as. And what's interesting is that initially there was this kind of denial that no, he governed just as he campaigned, which is not true. In other words, he campaigned as a populist, he governed as a populist. That's not true. By the end of his presidency, he was basically governing like Paul Ryan. That's not how he campaigned.
Right.
And in 2015, on the David Letterman show, Trump held up Scotland and Canada's single-payer healthcare systems as the ideal for America. He floated a $10 minimum wage. Like you said, he promised to not attack Social Security, Medicare, and Medicaid. His 2020 budget proposals, on the other hand, have huge cuts to all those programs. And so initially there was this kind of denial. And now there are some elements of the Trump movement that are trying to say, well, actually, this is a good thing. The Trump era, the Trump moment was entirely cultural. And in fact, Trump was a kind of needed return to Reaganomics. In other words, the very ideas that he challenged and made him so popular.
Yeah, and I guess, well, that's the question, though, right? Which is that he didn't run on that stuff in 2020, and the guy won more votes. He actually outperformed in several areas. So how does that kind of analysis fit? How does that fit into your analysis? Here's my contention. He would never have won 2016 without the populist economics. But you can leave some of that aside and still win a ton more votes just based on the culture war alone. But I don't necessarily think that that means that you can be Trump and also fully embrace, like, outwardly, like Mitt Romney being like, yeah, we're going to cut Social Security. I'm just trying to figure out what that portends for the future.
I think it's bad news. I think there's this latent tendency, obviously in the GOP, but also in, like I said, elements of the Trump movement to want to return to these ideas of, let's call it, economic liberalism, that are hugely unpopular, or I think I should say increasingly unpopular. And so how to square that with the fact that Trump lost, but the GOP seems to have done better on the local and state level. And I think that the GOP is either overlooking this because they're overlooking it, or they're doing it on purpose. But I think the GOP's success was contingent on the Democratic Party making itself basically the party of rioting and looting for the last 9 months or so.
Right.
Which, in other words, it made the Democratic Party so appealing that it kind of pushed people to the GOP. You know, there was this promise that the riots would come to the suburbs. Well, they did, and that helped the GOP. So the GOP is framing this as, well, this is actually a referendum in favor of tax cuts conservatism. And this just proves that our ideas, which Trump initially challenged to success, are actually very popular. Like, people want more tax cuts for people like Jeff Bezos. But it's very clear that that's just not true. And in fact, there's a growing— sorry, were you going to say something?
No. I mean, I just, the way I'm thinking about it, I think you're right 100%, is what does this portend, I guess, for the future? Because one of the things, the most accurate thing you pointed out, and a friend of mine, Aaron Saberi, I mean, just wrote this column, where he says one of the problems for people like us who, you know, see very clearly on the economics is that the crazier that the left is, it's easier to win without even talking about any of that. So how does that, do you think that that is going to be a dynamic that is going to perpetuate itself in the future? Is there a possibility that the left might even rein in some of those tendencies and they could be able to win more votes? And how must the GOP survive in these times?
No, it's exactly right. If the Democratic Party moderates itself, the GOP's in trouble. If the Democratic Party can rein in its more radical tendencies and become a populist party, a party for the people, then the GOP's in trouble because its ideas are the GOP's ideas are anti-social, anti-people. So, no, you're right that this is not a good trajectory for the party, especially like you said, and like I've said, if the Republican Party becomes a little bit saner culturally. But if you look at the growing body of evidence for things like Trump's tax cuts plan, what we're looking at is offshoring accelerating under Trump. And right. In fact, it seems to be the case that the tax cuts plan incentivized offshoring. And so these are things that are going to come back and I think haunt the Republican Party and haunt the Trump movement. Why did we run on an infrastructure plan that was by two-thirds of Americans considered the most important, the most popular promise of the Trump administration in 2017? And we dropped that for a tax cuts plan that was considered by political scientists Jacob Hackett and Paul Pearson the second least most popular piece of legislation in a quarter century.
Yeah, it's kind of amazing. And I love pointing this out. The lowest that Trump's approval rating ever got in the history of his presidency was right after those tax cuts. Not Charlottesville, none of this other stuff. It was the tax cuts. Hopefully some people will listen a little bit more to my friend Pedro Gonzalez. Everybody go check him out on Twitter and read some of his writing. Really excellent stuff. Pedro, thank you for joining us, my man. We really appreciate it.
Thanks so much for having me.
Absolutely. We will be right back with Washington Post economics reporter Jeffrey Stein. We're going to talk about where Congress is with stimulus. That's next.